All right, we are live on Facebook. We have the Facebook watch party happening. We are on Zoom. Good morning, everybody. Welcome home. Welcome to our Sunday celebration of love. I am Helen Velo, Reverend Helen Velo, and we come together on Sundays to celebrate the power of love, that infinite, beautiful power of love that is everywhere possible.
Facebook watch party happening. We are on Zoom.
I have to turn good down the Facebook watch party. So I don't hear myself twice this morning. So thank you for being with us. And before we start, well, we are starting, I have really wonderful, wonderful news to share with you. And that is our very own now Reverend Fred Wilmette is with us, and he went through a week of paneling, started out on Monday. He's been in ministerial studies for 2 years with Dr. James Mellon at the Global Truth Center and through Emerson Theological Institute. He was with 18 other brilliant minds, and oh my goodness. So this last week, he had workshops, he had talks to listen to, he had to give his own talk, which you can see on Global Truth Center's Facebook page, and then he had to go through a panel. And if you don't know what a panel is, it's standing, well, he was sitting, because it was on Zoom, but in front of three ministers who pretty much put him through the ringer. And at the end, it is like this incredible sigh of relief, because you have to go offline. The ministers talk and they talk about, you know, is he, you know, qualified? Has he got that consciousness of being a minister? And then he comes back in and he gets the hooray, you are a minister. So congratulations to you, Fred. If you want to unmute yourself and just say a few words, I'm so, so happy for you. I'm excited to see what you're going to do in the world, because it'll be amazing things, and you earned this. Wow.
Well, thank you, Reverend Helen, and just wanted to just say how grateful I am to my fellow practitioners, to you, Reverend Helen, and to the entire community who have supported me throughout this last couple of years. I mean, the texts, the emails, the middle of doing a thesis, which is one of the biggest stretches for me ever. And I would get a text from somebody saying, hey, hang in there, just thinking about you. And I would think, oh, I could do this. So just that throughout the last couple of years has been terrific. We have an incredible, amazing, incredible community, and know that we were well represented from Kauai to Palm Springs to LA. And so Toronto was well represented in that class for sure. And I'm just so grateful for everything. And, you know, Carrie's meditation was on the unknown. I am stepping into the unknown with open arms, wide open. I'm taking 6 months rest. That doesn't mean I'm stopping. I'm still working and all of those great things. And I'm available to anybody in our community anytime as well. So just thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I have abandoned ship. I was moving also last week, so I was moving Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday while I was doing the talk and while the paneling was going on. I abandoned ship and came out to my summer place here just for a night, just to get away, and now I step into whatever's next with open arms, and just know that I love you all. I see your faces. Even though we can't be together in person, I see your faces, and just feel the hug. That's what I want you to feel, is feel the hug. So thank you, and namaste, everybody.
Yay. I'm so happy for you, Fred. Congratulations. I send you so much love, and we've got lots of people online here saying congratulations to you, and just so thrilled for you, and I do know what it takes, so bless you, and I know that you'll be doing great things with Welcome Home Toronto and great things out in the world as well. So thanks for being on this morning so we could just really acknowledge all your work over the last couple of years and your consciousness.
Thank you very much. Yes, yes, consciousness.
Consciousness.
From that higher state of consciousness, which I can totally explain through and through now. If anybody would like a lesson. Not that anybody here needs one.
No. We got a great group of conscious people here this morning. So thank you, Fred. I'm going to hand it over to our guest musician this morning, Phil Jacobs. He's got a great song to lead us in with. So take it away, Phil.
Thank you, Helen. And this is a great song by the infamous Otis Redding. And based on like the lovely meditation that Carrie gave to us this morning. So thank you for that. This is finding that dock of the bay that we need to find that place inside ourselves. Here we go.
Ships rolling, and I'll watch them roll away again. So I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Left my home in Georgia, he headed for the Frisco Bay, 'cause I had nothing to live for, and looking like nothing's gonna come my way. So I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tides roll away. I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Look like nothing's gonna change, 'cause everything still remains the same. I can't do what 10 people tell me to do, so I guess I'll remain the same. Sitting here resting my bones, and this loneliness won't leave me alone. It's 2,000 miles I roam just to make this dock my home. So I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time. Oh, da 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 da. I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting the time, roll away. I'm just sitting on the dock of the bay, wasting time.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Oh, just, you know, if you think of sitting on the dock of the bay, just taking in all of what life has to offer. And as we move into our ritual of lighting candles for traditions and religions in the world, because there is, and I'm going to do it, I have a little bit something a little bit different to say about each one today, and yet it's all the same. You know, we get to understand that in our oneness, that consciousness of oneness, that there is that thread of understanding there is an infinite power for good, that is love. It is everywhere present. It is who and what we are. And to be able to truly claim it and live from it. So as I light these candles, this candle, we have one candle. A couple of weeks, we'll go back to the center broadcasting. And we'll have many candles to light. But I recognize Hinduism as the oldest religion in the world. And it talks about treat others as you would want yourself to be treated. And then Judaism, what you yourself hate, do to no being. And then in Buddhism, hurt not others, that with that which pains yourself. And then Christianity, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And in the Tao, regard your neighbor's gain as your own gain. Regard your neighbor's loss as your own loss. Confucianism, is there any one maxim that ought to be acted upon on one's whole life? Surely the maxim of loving kindness is such. Islam, do unto all beings as you wish to have done unto you. And the Baha'i faith, the oneness of religion, the oneness of all humankind. And in our First Nations traditions, live in harmony, for we are all related. So in understanding in this new thought philosophy, going back to all the new thought philosophers and specifically Ernest Holmes in The Science of Mind, we are spiritual beings living in a spiritual universe, governed by our own individual use of the law of cause and effect. And we can be such a powerful, powerful cause for change in this world. And so, you know, this is the golden rule that threads through every religion, every philosophy, and we know it. We know it in our memory. Can we commit to living it in our life? Can we commit to being it so fully and completely in our life? And I recognize also the light in each and every person, the light in each and every person who right now is standing up for what truly matters, for the eradication of racism and injustice, for the highest and best good of all of us, for each one of us to confront our own shadows and to transform our own shadows into light, so that we all stand so fully and completely in the light at all times. So this light is also for each and every one of you that is on Zoom, that is on Facebook Live, that watches later on in the archives or watches on YouTube. Bless you. Bless you. Be the change. Be that light that we all wish to see in the world. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to our brilliant practitioner of the day, Ellen Tompu, to take us into our affirmative prayer.
Good morning, everybody. And I invite you all to just take a moment to be silent and to breathe and to just feel this space in which we are joined together as one spirit, as one being. There is nothing but this good, this love. And despite circumstances, each and every one of us here sees the power, the beauty, the grandeur, the joy, and the love that is who we are. I trust and know that in our hearts, we each feel courage. We each feel a certainty, an absolute beingness that responds to everything we encounter each and every day. We are strong, we are love, and we are goodness. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to meet with like-minded people, people who are searching together for the truth, and that we join together in this moment, in this peace, knowing that we are one. And I release this word to the law, knowing that it is all good, it is all perfect, and together we say, and so it is.
And so it is. Thank you, Ellen. And Phil, I'll hand it over to you for your invocation song, For What It's Worth.
Something happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me, oh, I got to beware. I think it's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. What a field day for the heat. 1,000 people in the street. Songs and carrying signs, getting so much resistance from behind. It's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Battle lines being drawn. Nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people speaking their minds, getting so much resistance from behind. It's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. A paranoia strikes deep into your hearts, it will creep. Starts when you're always afraid. You step out of line, the man come and take you away. We gotta stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop now, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop. Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Ooh. to stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Ellen, I'm going to pass it back over to you.
Okay, so there's a lot going on, right? And it's hard to look at. So our affirmation is, I follow the inspired direction of my own inner knowing. And Andrew, with you here, call me out on anything I've screwed up, okay? Okay. So in 1972, when I was 10 years old, I lived in Guelph, and there were no Black people living there that I knew of. And Indira moved in and came to my school, and I took her under my wing, held her hand walking to school, would go to her home and have roti and feel uncomfortable. She was at the door one morning when I went to pick her up with white powder all over her face, and she was in pain. And I would stand up for her at school. I would visit her in the home and feel uncomfortable, but I was doing my Christian duty. I had a mission right in my backyard. What the, and you can fill in the what the. I went to school for 3 years in Minnesota, in Minneapolis. And there I saw ridiculous racism. Racism I never imagined. I took a tour of Kearney Green in Chicago and couldn't believe how horrible it was. But there's so much poverty, but it's not remotely to do with poverty. It's the whole situation. My daughter's best friend for years in elementary school was Black. And finally, her mom would not let her see us because Maya would go home frustrated, and she didn't live like us and have what we had. So Roxanne, as a single mother in community housing, wanted to do the best for her child. And I believed that this was due primarily to our financial discrepancy. But I see now it was so, so much more than that. And Maya was pulled away from white people in the school and the neighborhood, and the issue is so deep. So nowadays, in relationship, I don't believe, after much reflection, that I see Black friends and acquaintances any differently. We have relationships. But what about overall in society? What do I see? I see the anger in marginalized Black youth. And I was just about to say, I get it, but I don't get it. I know the roots are deep and the issues are complicated. And I see the disproportionate level of socioeconomic status. I saw a moving truck come to a multi-million dollar home in my neighborhood. I don't live in a multi-million dollar home by any means, as many of you know. And when the family arrived, they were Black. And my first thought was surprise, and then a kind of condescending, good for them, understanding that it took them so much to get there, and it was so much more challenging than it would be for others. But listen to me, I'm saying them, and I'm sure that every Black person, every single day, somehow feels watched and I'm sorry, I've been thinking about this a lot, and judged and misunderstood on some level by the people around them. What a thing to live with. This is a complicated systemic concern that's evolved over 400 years and more, and it's so easy to say it's worse in the US, but looking at recent numbers about the systemic racism in Canada, it's so revealing that that Black minorities here, more than any other minority, are more impoverished, have less opportunity, have less education. I saw graphs that blew me away, and the circumstances to Black lives are so unique. So there is an issue here, and we cannot speak words of love and compassion and not look straight in the eye and take action in our hearts and in our minds and physically take action. Regardless, I'm sorry, I can't believe this is happening. Regardless of our discomfort, I had something that I posted on Facebook the other day, and I deleted it a few minutes later because I did not have the courage to step up and say what I wanted to say. So, we need to get over, we don't need to get over the story. We know the stories. We know what's going on out there. And there was one thing that struck me really deeply this past week, and it's kind of pop culture, and it comes from James Corden. And he had a wonderful monologue, very impassioned statement on the situation. But what struck me was he checked in with his music director, Reggie Watts, I believe, sorry, and how he was doing. And the man grew up in the Midwest. He took violin lessons. He had biracial parents. He is a multimillionaire, I checked. And he said he didn't feel human growing up. He felt like he was part of a demographic. And as he was speaking, he broke. And in that moment, I felt the pain and how marginalized he was in society. This man was a multimillionaire. Why did this bother me so much? I thought about it and thought about my biases. And sure, successful Black people have been at the receiving end of racism, no question, but they've made it. And they've made it in the overall way that we think success should be. That was my thinking, my bias. And yes, they're concerned, they march, they speak, they're okay because they're successful, right? But what defines success and what brings peace? And this is not an issue of meeting our cultural standards of success. This is pain. This is a soul pain. And it's a pain of not feeling human, as he said. It's a pain that we who are not Black must bear witness to, and we must understand. Okay, so pop culture, but Oprah went to a Paris boutique looking for purses, and she didn't have makeup on, and they wouldn't let her look. And she's a billionaire, and she's confident, and of course, she felt the pain. In that moment, stripped bare and not being acknowledged as a human being, she felt that pain. So I don't necessarily have the material security I would like, but I have a beingness in this physical society that is not questioned, that is not judged, that is not diminished. I have peace from that, from not being considered less than. So it is fine to block out our status on Facebook, march and protest, but we must do these things through the inspired direction of inner knowing. Do them with reflection and understanding of what the statement being made truly is. Not joining a movement, or taking part in a trendy action that will pass, but through reflection and searching and purpose, we need to act and speak in whatever way is right to us. Bearing witness is not watching images to the point of exploitation. We need to bear witness in love, not separation, inclusion, oneness. We need to show tenderness. Open our hearts as vessels for the truth and step out of our comfort zone. We need to take action, knowing we do not understand the pain and accept that we don't understand it. Question, speak, ask. Stand up, be willing to make mistakes, say the wrong thing, be willing to unintentionally offend in our heartfelt desire to learn, to meaningfully become part of the change. We need to hear the anger and not condemn it, to know our oneness. We have to understand that part of who we are in our oneness is a feeling, and to allow the expression of that feeling and bear witness, not in the framework of our understanding as it stands with our limitations, but by expanding it with love, to embrace and hold space and allow for the emotions. And I'm showing emotions, I'm so sorry. Moving forward in our discomfort to elicit the change that is vital to the growth and evolution of all of us as human beings. To treat Black people as equals. We don't just commit to equality. We have to change our lives. Be honest, be uncomfortable. Ernest Holmes says, and I just lost it, that's good. I lost what Ernest Holmes says. And he's very wise. So sorry. A change of consciousness does not come by simply willing or wishing. It's not easy to hold the mental attention to an ideal while the human experience is discordant, but it is possible. Knowing the truth is not a process of self-hypnosis, but one of gradual unfoldment of inner self. Freedom is the birthright of every living soul. We can break this cycle by reflection and can look for alternative courses of action. If we look at another person's suffering and not treat it as a spiritual practice, we don't face the upsetting realities. We can avoid the emotion. Offering help is one thing, but turning our witness into a spiritual practice will bring structural transformation. By bearing witness as a spiritual practice, our hearts align with what is necessary, but we don't take on the muddiness of the condition, as Ernest Holmes says. We don't look away, avoiding discomfort, quite the opposite. To bear witness, we pay close attention to what one is seeing, staying with the sight, allowing our thoughts to thoughtfully probe the situation, noticing details about what is occurring. We need to be fully present and enter a state of mindfulness without distraction. As a spiritual practice, bearing witness is an act of intention and an act of attention. While what we are seeing may be ugly and uncomfortable to experience, we willingly stay with the situation. We cultivate a mental framework of openness, centered, respectful, compassion-filled feeling. Our connection to something other than us is larger than ourselves. And through spiritual practice of bearing witness, we can fully experience the sacred and initiate the change in our hearts. A spiritual container is created which frames all that follows. All of our actions are infused with reverence, allowing a depth of purpose to permeate our lives. We can observe the suffering and hold it in our heart, maintaining dignity, which shines out into the world. Wayne Mellinger said, from this spiritual practice, the strength and courage we need to bear witness is enabled. When we fully empathize with another, gather information about the issue, and share it in our community. It allows us to experience how our privileges are cut from the same cloth as these people's pains. Let's examine our hearts. Let's be honest with ourselves and bear witness with love. Let's initiate change with universal spirit, law, and love. So, our affirmation, which I'll say once, and if we can all repeat it out loud or together in our hearts, I follow the inspired direction of my own inner knowing. So we, together, I follow the inspired direction of my own inner knowing. Sorry. Anyway, thank you.
Oh, Ellen, thank you so much. Thank you. It was so heartfelt and authentic and raw and honest. Thank you. I'm going to pass it over to Phil. He has a song that he's written, and if you want to say something about that, Phil, and just everybody can take a breath in and just breathe into this beautiful heart space that we all have, knowing that it's allowing ourselves to open up to the rawness, to the authentic beingness of who we are that is so potent and needed. So, Phil, you want to say a little bit about your song there?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Helen. It's the song that I'm going to do is actually a song. It's not written by me, but it talks about, and it sort of like expands on what Ellen just spoke about meeting the darkness and meeting the uncomfortability inside of ourselves, and the empathy and the sympathy and the fierce compassion that we have to have in those moments. So it speaks. It's a song by the Rolling Stones, actually. That back in the day, because they were back in the protests in the 60s and everything like that, and it speaks to that which is uncomfortable, which we have to meet. We can't ignore, and we can't just turn a blind eye to what is surfacing external and also internally.
Please allow me to introduce myself, 'cause I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. I've stolen a many a man's soul and faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. I made sure that Pilate washed his hands and sealed his fate. I'm pleased to meet you. I hope you guess my name. Oh, what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. I stuck around St. Petersburg, but when I saw it was time for a change, I killed the Tsar and his ministers. Anastasia screamed in vain. I rode a tank, held a general's rank, when the blitzkrieg raged and the bodies stank. to meet you. Who hope you guess my name. Oh yeah. Oh, what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. I watch with glee while your kings and queens fought for 10 decades for the gods they made. I shouted out who killed the Kennedys when after all it was you and me. Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. As I lay the traps for the troubadours who get killed before they reach Bombay. I'm pleased to meet you. I hope you guess my name. Oh yeah, oh, what's puzzling you is the niche of my game. Just as every cop is a criminal, and all you sinner saints, as heads as tails, just call me Lucifer, 'cause I'm in need of some restraint. So if you meet me, have some courtesy, I have some sympathy and some taste. Use all your wealth on politics, or I'll lay your soul to waste. I'm pleased to meet you and hope you guess my name. Oh, what's puzzling you is the niche of my game. Pleased to meet you and hope you guess my name. Oh, what's puzzling you is the niche of my game.
It's a very powerful song, and in that song, when we name what is surfacing, we can meet it, we can change it, we can transform it. It's only when it's ignored and suppressed that it comes like a beast. So naming it, and we're naming all of that which is showing up inside of us these days and seeing it externally and internally. And when we name it, we can meet it and greet it and transform it.
Beautiful. Thank you. Oh my gosh. First of all, I'm going to switch us on to gallery view because what an incredible conversation here this morning. And whether it's the conversation through music, the conversation through spoken word, the conversation through meditation, it is an important and timely conversation as we are now shedding. We are shedding a skin that we have been living in, a container that has created some kind of illusion that we live in safety, and if we just stay in our little bubble and it's all good and we all get to just continue. Well, guess what? It's not working out that way. It is so not working out. We are smacked in the face with change. We are confronted with looking at how we deal with our lives, looking at our own consciousness, looking at who we are and how we show up. And it has been, you know, this gift from the universe since, well, for us here in Canada, Toronto, since March. And in other parts of the world, it started much earlier. But it's happening on a global level, and we can't ignore it. We cannot ignore what was going on in our own lives. We cannot ignore what was going on environmentally. We cannot ignore what was happening systemically with our society. And the funny thing is that, well, not so funny, but haha, funny. I, on Tuesday, when I was on the Conscious Cafe with Dr. Mitch Abrams, and we were talking about a piece of art that he created, and it was a tearing of the fabric of society. Yes, I do, Judy, because I'm going to be speaking back and forth, so I did mean to show gallery view. So what happened is that on the Conscious Cafe, at one point, Dr. Mitch Abrams and I were talking about the tear in society and what was going on. And at one point I looked at him and I said, do you realize that you and I are two white privileged people having this conversation? And yes, it's an important conversation that we're having, but we don't have, you and I going back and forth, we're not completing the whole picture here. So what I thought I would do today is bring someone that a lot of you will know, because he and his beautiful wife, Sonia, and their amazing kids used to come to the center, Andrew Reed. Andrew is, if you have seen anything that he has posted on Facebook, his consciousness is so evolved. And he exudes this incredible love. So I thought, who better to have on with me today, thank you, is Andrew Reed. So welcome, and thank you, Andrew.
Thank you for the warm welcome, Helen.
So good to see you. So I want to ask you, how are you through all of the upheaval that is happening and the tragedy that has happened, especially the last four lives that have been lost in yes. The US, and how are you with all of this, knowing that I know you have a point of view that is, well, you tell me your point of view. I'm not going to
No problem. It's I'll start off with the incident itself that has ignited the world here. When I first saw that, the images, the video of what happened to George Floyd, I have to be honest, I felt anger at first. But then, as everything started to unravel, and I saw what was ignited here, I realized that something beyond is happening, something very divine. I've never seen in my lifetime, I was born in the 70s, a release of compassion like I've seen before. What's happening right now in my community is there's a lot of pain that has not been released. It has not been processed and released. And this is what is happening right now. We are going through a time where we are going over, we're allowing people to talk about the pain that they've experienced in their life. And because that is happening, and because this pain is being released, compassion now is dominating, okay? And because I can pull back and see the big picture, not just the incident, when it happened. I can pull back and see what is happening around the world. I feel gratitude for what's happening, because this is something that's, it has to be dealt with, and it's being dealt with. And I know that at the end of this, when all the turbulence is over, we will be in a better world. We will see what we've created. This is what we've been dreaming about, a world that's a little bit more compassionate, a little bit more loving.
Yeah, you know, I have to say that in my prayers, I give such gratitude for the souls that have, including George Floyd, that have been this way of waking us up. I am like, thank you for giving your life. Thank you for putting your life on the line, because I don't know what it was going to take for all of us to really kind of go, whoa, wait a minute here. We cannot let this continue.
Just like what you said, and what I'm about to say here is going to be unpopular for some people, because we're still going through the process of dealing with the pain, but that's how I'm able to have compassion for the officer who took his life. I have compassion for him and not anger. You know, because of him and what he did, he has allowed this moment to play out. And I can't separate the two. I cannot. That incident ignited what we see now. And I'm grateful that this is happening now. That's all I can say, is that I'm just really grateful, because a lot of pain is going to be processed in the next little while. And we're going to see a bigger outpouring of compassion and love.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for saying that. Yes. It's such an important thing to acknowledge, because it's not just the people who lost their lives. It's everyone who was involved that was in contribution to this awakening, and they've all played a part. And someone said to me the other day, you know, how grateful they were that the police officers were charged accordingly. And yes, that needs to happen. And that system needs to follow through to ensure that they are experiencing the consequences that are equal to what their crime was. But then they said, and I hope they just suffer and suffer and suffer while they're in jail and everybody gangs up on them. And that's where I go, whoa, no, that is not for us to even step into and consider, because then we've just created separation. We've just created more judgment. We've just created more anger, and we're actually being vindictive. And if anything, my wish for for all of this is that we do get to that deep place of compassion and love, no matter what, and forgiveness, because that is the only way we will continue to move forward and really create that space for everyone to share their feelings. But not just blab them all out, but then to come to some kind of conscious resolution within ourselves, but also within what needs to change systemically.
Yes, I agree with you 1,000%. It's difficult, and we have to allow space for, because we have to acknowledge first that everybody's at different stages with their pain. So, you know, I can understand where the anger and the rage comes from. And I think it's important just to listen, to really listen at first and allow that to come out. And once that happens, we'll deal with it. I know that we're going to move forward together as a society and correct the injustices that are in the system, because they still exist. You know, they're getting better, but they still exist. And we're going to take a quantum leap here, because this is such a, there's so much energy that's being focused on it right now. We're going to have a quantum leap in how we view our laws and how we view each other. And it's beautiful.
Yeah. Well, what we focus on is fans. So the fact that we're actually focusing our attention on this with a commitment to do something about it, because we need the action as well. There was something, I wanted to ask you, how are your children with this?
You know what? My children are, they're not even aware, to be honest with you, that what's really going on, because the energy that's in my house, it doesn't really allow for them to feel strange. I know that as they grow, the reason why we're going through this process right now is so that when my children get to my age, these discussions aren't even going to be necessary. We'll be done with it. So I know that, you know, what we're going through now, there's purpose behind it. And my children are just, I look at them as, they're so close to source that this has not corrupted anything in them whatsoever. They still love, and they will continue to love.
Wow. And that's because you and Sonia are so close to support, right? Both of you, if you are living in love and compassion, and that is the field in your household, of course your kids are going to be okay.
For sure. We do our best.
What would you like to see happen? What would be a really, what's a measurable outcome that you would like to see from this?
What I'd like to see happen, and I was having a discussion very late at night last night with a close friend of mine, and we were going over ideas. And one of the things that I'd like to see happen is I'd like everybody to be heard. Okay, so let's all the people who feel, you know, the pain, let them talk about it. Then something that's measurable I look at is, let's put some body cameras on the police officers from now on, so that, you know, there's more accountability with the people who are enforcing our laws, right? I think if we put body cameras on them that cannot be turned off, I think that is something that's measurable, something that will help ease the pain. And then I'm hoping that, and this is just me, that at some point in time, we won't even need cameras, because we'll just all be so close to source and we won't need anything like that.
That's beautiful. You know, you talking about allowing people to be heard, of course, this is very much an issue for our First Nations community as well, that experiences the same systemic racism, and very much in their culture, storytelling and creating that space to be heard and allowing that, you know, creating that benevolent space for people to be heard is very much a part of their culture and part of the healing. And that can, you know, that's can go across any culture to create that opportunity, because it is in being heard and feeling heard. I mean, we want to feel seen. We want to be heard. We want to be able to feel safe and secure. And so, you know, that's where each one of us in our own consciousness as well, if we're willing to create that space for people and allow that to happen, there's so much potential for healing And, you know, you're talking about the body cameras on police officers and that it would get to a place where, you know, we're all in this flow of source that none of that is needed. And I, you know, that's where I think also work on meditation and teaching officers how to really build up resiliency and stay in that place of coherence so that they can access a different part of their brain and really process properly is so valuable in changing how we operate and how we see things. So, and you know, I know that that's possible. I see it, I feel it, I embody it, and I claim it now that kind of connection and support and love and sharing is possible. Sooner it's done, you know, as you, as myself, as the practitioners and each and every person on this service, take that action to, first of all, work on our own consciousness, but then hold space for conversation.
Absolutely. There's going to have to be some work in the community as well, because when I talk about pain that Black people and all minorities, I would say, but I'm speaking of the community that I'm in, you know, there is a part of us, because of the conditioning over the years, that makes us feel less than, right? So there is, we must acknowledge that that's there, and we got to work on removing that mindset. I'm lucky that I was able to process the painful moments that I've been through in my life when I had to deal with prejudice and racism, because I knew my value. I was able to work through it. I knew my value. I know that I come from a source of love, and I am love. So people who would mistreat me, I would show I'd feel compassion for them. I'd say they're missing out, you know, but I was at a stage in my life where I could say that confidently, that they were missing out on a relationship with me. And that's how I was able to move on from that. A lot of people in the community, they're not there yet. So we need to work on building confidence and letting them grow and understanding that they're beautiful and their contribution, that they have so much to offer this world to make it a better place. I think once we get there, you know, a lot of these things are going to fade away naturally, because our natural state is love. Our natural state is love. We don't like holding on to things that get us away from that. So that's my view.
Yes, it is our natural state. That is, you know, and for us to be able to accept it. But I think what you were saying too, Andrew, about the feeling unworthy, I mean, that goes right back to deep-seated shame of somehow I'm flawed, I'm defective, I'm not enough. And that shame will just have us spiral down. And it's such a... an intense, dark, horrible feeling that we don't want to feel it. And yet the only way to heal shame, you got to feel it to heal it. The only way to heal unworthiness is to feel it to heal it. You got to go through it to come out to the other side to get, oh, no, I am source. I am God. I am God and I am this incredible love. And so I am, again, what an incredible vision. What a gift you are, Andrew, to, first of all, your family, which please give them my love. And to all those around you, to your community, please keep putting out what you are putting out on Facebook, because it is so powerful and healing for not only for everyone.
I feel like I'm starting to find my voice, and that this is my purpose is to bridge that gap, because I don't believe in coincidences. My dad was the second Black police officer in Toronto, so I have an understanding of the other side of policing and what happens, you know. So I know the majority of men and women that serve, the large majority of them are great human beings who sacrifice, you know, every day going out trying to protect the community. And it's just unfortunate that the smaller group of them who are not helpful, who do harm, seem to get all the headlines. So I just want to make sure that those police officers who do their job day in, day out really well get acknowledged and know that I appreciate them, my community appreciate, we appreciate them as a community, and please keep going, because their time to shine is coming. I believe it. I really believe it, that what they're doing is going to be highlighted a lot more in the future.
Wow. Thank you.
You're welcome.
That's amazing that your father was the second Black police officer. That's, you know, you've been in there living it. And I'm so grateful that you came on today. Thank you so much. It's been wonderful to hear your voice. It's too short a time to have, you know, it's like we just a little bit of time to have this conversation. And it's, you know, may we have further conversations and community conversations as well, which is also so valuable.
Yes, absolutely. Anytime you want me to be on here, I'll be on here to talk about anything.
thank you, bless you. And I am actually going to move us forward into our affirmation of divine giving. And so when we think of divine giving, and I, you know, like this is normally where we would pass the baskets at the center, which, you know, I'm coming up with a whole new way, because we're not going to do it that way anymore. We just, like, we need to move beyond that and think about our giving, not only financially, but emotionally, our intellectual acuteness that we can give, and our intellectual learning, our energy, it's all one. So as we move into our affirmation, I'm just going to do a quick screen share here. Divine love flows through me. It blesses and multiplies all that I have on all levels, all I give, and all that I receive. I am richly blessed, creating a greater and greater flow of abundance. And so it is. And so please, we do appreciate your donations. It's very much appreciated and needed to keep our beautiful home going and keeping all of this going online as well. We do have a board meeting today, and we're going to be discussing text to donate as well. So that will be an opportunity for people and make it really, really easy. But otherwise you can go to welcomeomtoronto.com, or you can send an e-transfer to admin@welcomeomtoronto.com. And just a couple of announcements. I'm still doing prayer at 8 a.m. Absolutely loving it. 15 minutes, like, just open up your mind to your unlimited potential and just have your subconscious mind saturated in spiritual principle to start your day. Our class schedule for this week, same as last week, it's all up on the website. You can catch us through Zoom, except for Phil's beautiful sound bath. Oh my God, it was amazing on Thursday on Facebook Live. And Carrie is, of course, on Thursday at 7 p.m., but all the rest are at 9 a.m. So please join us for meditation and get yourself in there for connecting into that beautiful, beautiful heart space that you have. Tuesday, we have our Songwriter Circle series. Oh my gosh, this Jacqueline is doing such an incredible job. We have Jamie, Emma, we have one other person as well who will be online with Jacqueline. I don't know where she finds these people, but they are brilliant, young, Canadian, talented songwriters and singers. And so let's support them on Tuesday night at 7 p.m. And our Friday kindness. Lynette, thank you. Thank you. She's got this whole group that comes in and makes these lunches that we distribute to the homeless on Friday afternoons. We do need more people to distribute. So please, if you can help us distribute, come by at about 12:30 on Friday, pick up some lunches, take them out. You'll see people, there are lots of people on the streets who are very grateful to receive a lunch. And then Andrew, thank you. Thank you so much for being on with us today. Phil, thank you for your incredible music. Carrie, your meditation was brilliant and bang on. And Ellen, your words today were stunning, heartfelt, deep, and provocative. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And thank you to all of you. Thank you for being on Facebook Live. Thank you for being on Zoom. Love you, love you, love you. I am going to look at starting to broadcast from the center in the next couple of weeks. You know, we'll get it up and running. So we'll move over there, which will just, we'll have much better production value. But until then, keep joining us on Zoom and Facebook. Love you lots. And Phil, I'm gonna have you take us out with your final song and great conversation. So I my heart is full. Thank you all. And over to you, Phil.
Thank you. Thank you, Helen. Thank you. What an amazing, amazing ceremony. So I had another song planned, but I feel like this is the song to close with the I Am and the oneness with the universe and the system. It's a song I wrote, and here we go. But thank you. Thank you, everyone. All of the things that come to me in my dreams, from the hell to the great big sky. And I stand all of the time, and I wonder all of the time, the biggest questions of why. Am I here all on my own, or am I a part of the zone, twilight time? Where is my home? So I ask the trees all of the time, what is really all mine? Will I end up fine all on my own? Just be trees all say, 'cause we are just being okay with what we are. We are all the same.
what we found, and all we need is what is around. My life is your life now, and my breath is your breath now, and my heart is your heart now. Da 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 da. Oh, da 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 da. Just be the trees all say, 'cause we are just being okay with what we are. We are all the same, connecting beneath the ground. Just look at what we found, and all we need is what is around. My life is your life now, and my breath is your breath now, and my heart is your heart.
So beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Phil. You're an incredible songwriter.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Have a beautiful, beautiful Sunday. We'll see you next week. Much love to you. Bye for now. And thank you again, Andrew. And my heart is full. Bless you. Thank you.